86 may look not such an impressive move. Black refrains from developing. He also closes the diagonal of his c8 bishop. And still, this move was played twice by Kasparov in his last match against Karpov. He played in the 13th and in the 15th game of that match. So it certainly should have some merit. The idea is that Black is taking preventive measures against White's main threat, which was d5 mainly. So actually Karpov played d5 the first time he got this position, but somehow the position proved too static for White to claim an advantage, and it ended in an interesting draw. I will not insist here. I will use this game in the interactive section with questions for the reader. So we should just focus on the strongest move, which Karpov, this was a novelty by that time. Karpov played it in the 15th game. Since Black didn't develop a piece on his previous move, White can do the same. Just make a something against the development, but his strategic goal is clear. The last move created some weaknesses on the king side. Okay, the move itself weakened only these two moves, these two squares, but actually the whole king side is now weak. And well, of course, there is some danger of a direct attack, but Karpov could not hope to mate Kasparov. But the exchange of bishop is good in any case. So it's obvious that Black cannot really afford to take here. Now he has to parry the straight knight g5, and he's not in time creating counterplay in the center, because now bishop d3 followed by e5 would be simply killing. With these pieces here, you cannot let your king expose this way. So Kasparov played the logical move, knight c6. He has to catch up in development, of course. And h4 puts more pressure on Black. If allowed to play h5, White would already get a very strong attack. So time had come for Black to release the tension in the center. And he had to take on g7 first. And now they reached what may look as a typical Grünfeldinning, but the fact that the bishops are off has two consequences. This king feels a little bit insecure, and these squares, especially f6, is likely to be occupied by White at a certain point. And on the other hand, this king feels very safe, and it can defend the d4 pawn from e3, which is a square that became available. And with four rooks on board, there are still some attacking ideas. So Black should permanently watch the tactic danger and the strategic danger, and this is not easy to live with. Bishop d7. It's a logical move. Actually, it's the only reasonable move. B6 is not possible, and this would be somehow strange, opening the C file without being developed. So bishop d7, and probably Black hoped to get some counterplay as soon as possible this way. But now rook b1 was an interesting move from Karpov. He anticipates the possibility of a rook opposition on the c-file, so he causes Black some lack of coordination by attacking here. And now Kasparov's decision was slightly surprising. Rook b8. He kept his knight on c6 because he wanted to transfer it to e7. Which is also not something very natural. Knight a5, as recommended by Seyravan, in his book Five Crowns, it's more natural and probably safer, but it doesn't mean that that this would equalize in any way. Through what black would get some activity, the white attack is not so dangerous because there are such things like knight c4 or rook or d8 or rook a3. So black has his own play, but white can then simplify to a very nice ending. h6 is a pleasant move to play if you know that all the rooks are exchanged. And now e5 is some sort of threat, and if f6, then g4, yes, or knight g5 was also possible, and if f6, then g4. Somehow black has some problems in the ending. He will have these three pawns on light squares, and that's almost a guarantee that his bishop will be a bad one. And nobody can say that it's losing, but it's very unpleasant to defend over the board. Rook ab8. Karpov played bishop d3. It's strange he doesn't play h5 at once. But okay, because now the annotators recommended h6, but then g4 would be very strong. There would be no attack for white, but he would get the strategic favorable configuration in any case. So Kasparov continued his plan, which remains a little bit mysterious to me. Knight e7, h5, and now f6, because of course you have to do something against white's plan on dark squares. And also there was this threat to take here, and then knight g5, threatening rook h7, and rook h8 would in fact lose a pawn, because after rook takes h8, either this pawn or this pawn would be hanging. It's not so easy to understand why the knight here stands so well, because these squares are under control, and Kasparov couldn't really think seriously to take with the knight on g6, because this would leave him with a horrible structure. So well, only he will tell probably in his next volume. And play continue like this. Now rook h2. Of course, we can see that Karpov did not give up his ambitions to attack the king. He prepares rook here, but the move is generally waiting for black to define his intentions. And Kasparov played b6. He probably wanted to play rook h8 and didn't want to be forced to go with the king back. He frees his rook. And he also prepares a maneuver that actually could have cost him dearly, rook b7, because this way he would justify this maneuver and everything he did so far. And now g4. g4 is maybe the move that Kasparov underestimated. When playing knight e7, he must have thought that he prevents e5 in view of knight d5. So this would mean that his position would be safe, and that his the Achilles heel of his position would be safe. But g4 is a very strong move, and it many times happened that it's better to attack such a weakness like f6 with a wing pawn, not with a central pawn, because the central pawn may have some important functions, such as now to control this knight. So g4, the threat g5 is very unpleasant, and Kasparov tried to change the course of the game. But we can notice that his position is not much easier now. the g6 pawn is weak, and now the king is in some danger. There is a plan of f4 and d5. So this rook may arrive here, or maybe on h1. And curiously, the consequent move, rook b7, which Sese tries to justify everything he had done so far, now the threat is to play rook b7, this should actually have lost the game. Well, not after fc, like played by Karpov, when after rook b7, black was more or less fine. But after rook h4. And this is the moment to describe a little bit this game in general. It started like an attacking move, bishop h6. Well, the queen is on board, bishop h6 is not really an attacking move. Then it became a strategic game when the queens were off, and white was trying to occupy the dark squares. And then suddenly, now we get again an attacking position with the black king in a very big danger. For instance, if king g5, then either rook g1 or bishop e2 leads to mate. All these pieces are attacking the sole black king. And the more difficult variations arise after rook d7. Karpov probably missed something tactical in these lines. If 5 is a very strong move, once again the king on g5 is not promising anything okay. Analysis shows that this leads to mate again. The analysis is in the database. But the thing that Karpov might have missed was that that here this check and counter check can be met with another counter check, and now there is this this move winning material. Probably he missed something something about this, and it means that, well, the bishop has to go somewhere. But for instance, if bishop h5, then again there is a very strong attack for white. The king cannot go to g8 because of the fork on e6, and if he goes forward, then the attack is simply going on and on. I mean, black is obviously lost here. Or if bishop d7, then there is for instance f4, which is killing. Now there is no threat of rook d7, so f4 is just killing. He threatens e5, rook h1 followed by e5. It's very close to mate. Or if bishop c8, then some other problems may arise. Rook c1 is strong in this case, because again this move is not something to be proud of, because now the king has big problems. So all in all, this game proves that e6 is not really a good idea. There have been some games after that. You'll find some of my comments in the database, but one thing is clear. The problems put by bishop h6 are not easy to deal with for black. Black is obviously struggling in this line.